Welcome to Bethany United Methodist Church. I'm Julie Wilson, a senior pastor. My pronouns are she, her. I want to welcome you whether you're a member or a guest here and invite you to let us know that you're worshiping with us today. If you're on the Zoom, you can put your name in the chat. If you're in the sanctuary, you'll find a yellow sheet of paper in the pew in front of you. If you fill that out, that's helpful for us. Also on the back, there's a place for some serving opportunities, and other things, and also prayer requests, joys, and if you have a God sighting you wanted to lift up this week, you could put that there as well. I'm so glad that some of you made it on this snowy morning and that you made it safely, and for those who are on Zoom or YouTube, I'm glad that you're safe wherever you are as well. I'm glad that we can worship and experience God's presence today. God is here. God brought you here, and together we're going to meet God and in whatever you need today. I want you to know that you are welcome here, that everyone is welcome here. All of who you are is welcomed here by a God who loves you and knows you by name. As we begin worship this morning, Diane's going to lead us in our opening prayer.
Good morning. Please join me for our opening prayer. Gracious God, in love, open wide the doors and welcome us into your presence. Saints and sinners alike, you spread a table before us filled with the richest fare, a feast of love and mercy for the body and soul. We come with joy to meet you here, to taste and see your goodness, to celebrate your grace and mercy in our lives. May your Spirit inspire our praise and thanksgiving, our prayers and petitions, as we worship together in your presence. In the name of Jesus Christ, our host and Lord. Amen.
And we're going to join together in just a moment in our breakthrough prayer. But before we do that, I want to point out again that we have two tables up in the front of candles. And if you have experienced a God sighting this week, a breakthrough, or someplace where you felt God in your life, I invite you to, during our first song, come on up and light a candle. Also, or instead of, or in addition to, in the back, you'll find these little hearts and a little stick, and you can also put your God sighting on there and put it up straight on the bulletin board right in the back. And if you're on the Zoom call and you want to put that in the chat, we'll recognize those as well. As we are praying this breakthrough prayer, we're trying to be aware of the ways that God is present in our world and in our lives. And each and every day, I think we all experience God's presence. And sometimes we take it for granted, and we're trying to be open and listening to where God is working in our lives. So will you join me in this prayer? God of all possibilities, we are listening. Embolden us to recognize where love and hope are needed most. Amen. Now I invite you, if you're able, to stand and join in singing the summons. It's 21:30 in the Faith We Sing. And as I said, if you want to light a candle, you are welcome to do that during this song or any time during worship today.
Thank you.
I want to invite any children that we have to come forward if you'd like to be a little bit closer in the front row and see the pictures in the book that I'm going to share this morning. And as they're coming up, I want to welcome everyone on Zoom, and I'm so glad that you're with us today, and those who might come on YouTube too. You can come right here and sit in this row. So Miss Lisa is not here today, but she shared another one of her great books with me. And today we're talking about generosity. That's a big word. You know what that means, to be generous? Adult, can you help out? What does it mean to be generous?
Yeah. To give freely.
To give freely, yeah. Do you guys ever share things that you have? Yeah, that's kind of being generous. Okay, so this story, I'm gonna set this down so I don't lose it, is about a person who's generous. And I think you might be surprised by what he's generous with in the story. So let's read it. Hosea Plays On is the name of the story. Hosea tucked his shiny brass saxophone in its velvet-lined case and glanced at the wakening sky. On a day like this, he thought, I could play forever. He smiled. Maybe, just maybe, he would earn enough today. Getting ready. He stepped outside. Nate, his neighbor, looked up from raking leaves with his dad. Warning, they called. Nate lifted the rake handle to his lips and pretended to play. Keep practicing, my man, Hosea said with a tip of his hat. Hosea waited for the number 25 bus, then dropped in his coins. The city scrolled past, each stop bringing him closer to the public market. Hosea climbed down the steps and shuffled through the brittle dancing leaves. He stepped through the market's archway and shooed cooing pigeons that were scrounging for breakfast. Hosea made his way to his favorite playing spot near a coffee shop. Beneath gathering clouds, folks streamed into the market. Hosea settled in, opening his case, and pulled out his saxophone. He took a deep breath, then released a tune, long and low. Fingers fluttered, keys flicked. Smoky notes lifted through the air, threading along to waiting ears. People slowed, then stopped to listen to the melody. As the sun ducked toward the darkening clouds, a little girl stepped forward. She began to sway. The crowd hushed. She dipped and twirled her toes, a sweeping whisper. When the song was over, the girl curtsied, then poised for their next duet. But a peppering rain scattered the crowd to a nearby pavilion. Hosea played on. Later, Hosea sifted through the money in his case. No maybes about it. He'd earned enough. He packed up and made his way toward the market's exit. With a stop to make before heading home, he boarded the number 39 bus. The music shop store squeaked his arrival. Good afternoon, Mrs. May waved him in. What'll it be today? How about a nice trumpet to go? How many trumpet players does that band of yours need? Miss May teased. Always room for one more, answered Hosea. He chose one he thought was just right. Near home, Hosea stepped onto the sidewalk. He listened to the music of the day, scritch scratch of leaves, the whistle of the wind, the groan of a nearby bridge as a truck passed over it. With one hand hidden behind his back, Hosea watched Nate march toward him. His friend? How'd it go, Mr. Hosea? Like this, Nate. Put that phony horn away. Hosea pulled the trumpet case from behind his back, because now you have a real one to play. Nate's face lit up. For me? Thank you. He clutched the case to his chest. Will you teach me, too? Depends, answered Hosea. Are you ready to learn? They settled on the stoop. Hosea lifted the shiny brass trumpet from its velvet-lined case and handed it to Nate. The boy drew in a breath, then released a tangled note. Together, the two played on.
Why is Lisa not here?
She's gone today. She's out of town. Yeah. What did you think of the story? Did you like that story? So he shared not only his gift of music, right, but also his trumpet and teaching someone else to play. Lots of sharing and generosity in that story. Thanks for coming up, you guys. You can go back, and I think the bells are going to play now.
That was lovely. Thank you. Our scripture today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 35 through 40. I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothes to wear. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then those who are righteous will reply to him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and give you clothes to wear? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? Then the king will reply to them, I assure you that when you have done it for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you have done it for me. The word of God for the people of God.
Let us pray. God of love, as we hear the words of Scripture this day, as we ponder these words in our own hearts and lives, we pray that you would open us. We pray that we would feel your spirit moving in and among us. May the meditations of all of our hearts and the words of my mouth be pleasing and acceptable to you this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, I don't know, did my battery just die? Oh, there we go. Okay, sounds better. Technology, we gotta love it, right? So before I start, I just need to say something about those bells, because that was amazing. And from where I'm sitting, I was just watching like how many different ways y'all played the bells today. You know, not just dinging them, but using the mallets and hitting them on the table. It was amazing. Thank you. And thank you, Nick, for that. That was really great. I say that to butter you up before I give you this message. So there you go. So there's three things, right, you're not supposed to talk about. Anyone want to say what they are? Money, politics, religion. Well, guess what? I'm going to talk about two of the three today. As I was getting my thoughts together for the sermon this morning, I realized that as we're talking about our membership vows and our discipleship journey, I foolishly put money and evangelism on the same day. So as a recap, for the next few weeks, we're talking about our discipleship journey and how we live out our membership vows. And today we're talking about the vows to support the ministries of our church by our gifts and our witness. And when we say gifts, we mean money. And when we say witness, we mean evangelism. Two topics that we don't really like to talk about. And I put them in the same sermon. Now, wasn't that smart? Those of you who stayed home maybe today are thinking, yeah, I'm smart to stay home. I don't know. So you might notice that the sermon title says A Life of Hospitality and Generosity. And if Nick wants to show that little slide, he can. We're working through this discipleship chart that goes through our membership vows. And on there also it says generosity and hospitality. And the charts are in the back if you want one after worship today. And that's probably enough of showing that, because I know it's hard to read. But some people might say that I call it generosity and hospitality to make it kind of easier to swallow these taboo topics. But honestly, I don't believe that these topics should be taboo at all. And when Jesus talks about how we are to live, hospitality and generosity are pretty important. And so I hope that you'll bear with me in this message, and maybe, just maybe, I hope that you might even enjoy a sermon about money and religion. So as I said, the membership vows, we use the words witness and gifts. So who likes getting gifts? Right? Okay. So I was thinking about some of the best gifts that I've received. And I don't know about you, but they aren't necessarily the most expensive ones. They're the thoughtful ones. Sometimes they're the homemade gifts. The ones people who know me really well took the time to pick out especially for me. Sometimes they're a surprise, you know, a gift for no reason other than someone will say, I saw this and I thought of you and so I bought it for you. They're the pictures that children draw for me. I still have some from my very first congregation that I served. Or maybe it's the unexpected email or the note in the mail that really touches me. Those are the gifts that are precious to me. I guess it's kind of because of the unexpectedness and because of the love I feel. It's not an obligatory gift, but rather it's a gift given out of love and generosity. The fact that someone took the time to remember me and share something that they knew I would really appreciate. I thought about when I had cancer and all the generous gifts people gave to me and my family. I especially was thinking about when I had a PICC line in my arm and I was self-conscious of it, and it was summer, and one day I casually mentioned to one of my friends that I was having trouble finding things to wear because it was too warm to wear long-sleeve shirts, and yet I didn't really want this PICC line showing all of the time. The next day, she pulled in my driveway with 3 3-quarter length shirts she had purchased at Kohl's for me. I was so touched that she even remembered what I thought was just kind of a passing remark in a much larger conversation that we were having. And I also thought about gifts that people have given me that touched not just me, but other people as well. I don't know if I've shared before that when I was in high school, I had an exchange sister, Christina, who lives in Sweden. And we have stayed in contact over the years, and hopefully one of these days I'll get to go visit her again. Anyway, a few years ago, she experienced a tragic and sudden death of her 3-year-old. I felt like I was really needed to go and be with her. And so, of course, I asked for prayers from my church family at the time. And when I went to Bible study the next week, my class surprised me with an envelope full of cash to help pay for my plane ticket. Yeah, oh wow, right? I remember how moved I was by their generosity. And I also remember that when I told Christina, she wept. And she said, they don't even know me. And I said, yes, but they know me, and they know God. And their generosity moved Christina and gave her at least just a little bit of hope when her world seemed to be spinning out of control. And I'm going to guess that oftentimes our gifts to the church might not seem as important as that. Maybe you don't think they carry a lot of weight, or they are really that meaningful to other people. Well, yes, the money that you put in the offering plate or give online, you know, helps have the lights on and the heat, which we appreciate. Pastor Brad and I and the other staff members appreciate getting our paychecks. But your financial gifts to the church do more than that. They help pay our connectional giving, sometimes known as apportionments. Sometimes people don't like to say that word or think that it's a bad word. But our connectional giving supports lots of wonderful programs. It helps fund the Board of Ordained Ministry that trains and equips pastors like me. And not only just pastors to lead this congregation, but all over the state. Our connectional giving helps United Methodist Committee on Relief. And I know that most of you know about UMCOR and the things that they do, but for those who don't, they are one of the best disaster response things in the world, really. They're often the very first people there, long before the media gets there, and they stay long after the media. Our connectional giving helps support our camps. I was lucky enough to go this week and do some snowshoeing at Pine Lake. It was beautiful. Every time I'm there, I think about the people who have cared for that camp over the years and cared enough to save it for us so we could enjoy it. The MCCI process that we are a part of, and other worthwhile programs and opportunities. And in addition to that, your generosity helps our church to be a church, to be in ministry with our communities. And I know a lot of you don't ever see what happens beyond Sunday morning. For example, Pastor Brad and I both spent time this week talking with people who are going through incredibly difficult situations in their lives. I had the opportunity to work with other faith leaders to think about critical housing needs in our community. We talked about next year's Pride service and other topics related to justice. A few weeks ago, one of our Sunday school children marched down the hall and loudly proclaimed, "I love this church." And during the weekdays, our lower level is filled with young people and also amazing childcare workers who are so kind and patient and passionate about helping little ones. Many of those have very difficult life situations, including living in homelessness. And some days I can hear little ones running up and down the hall downstairs, and I can hear laughing and playing. And other days I can hear a full-on meltdown. And I'm glad that they have a safe space to feel loved and cared for. I could go on, but I hope you get the picture that your generosity is appreciated. A few months ago, I was having a conversation with a member of the finance team, and I said that church finances aren't for the faint of heart. That's because we do rely on generosity. And so often, I am completely astounded by people's generosity. Like the many people who continue to give faithfully during the pandemic, and the people who started worshiping online and gave financially, including one person who became one of the largest donors of our church without ever entering the building. And I believe that hospitality and generosity go hand in hand. Our God is a God of abundance. Our God is not a God of scarcity. And when we realize that, we are not only generous, but we are also welcoming. Our love for God flows into the love of our neighbors. Yesterday, we had a funeral here, and one of the people who spoke mentioned generosity and how that manifested in hospitality. Of course, that really perked up my ears. But they talked about how being generous included making people feel welcome and included. I think Jesus would approve of that, don't you? So how do we make people feel welcome? For the most part, I'm going to say you all are pretty good at that. You care deeply about one another, and it shows. I've been touched by how you have welcomed me and how patient you have been as I try to live into being your pastor. And I also have an ache in my heart for those who aren't here. For those who don't know what it's like to be part of a loving church family. And even more than that, for those who don't know that they are loved unconditionally by God. And that's where the scripture passage for this morning comes in. There's so many passages that I could have chosen about generosity and hospitality, but as I was thinking and preparing, this one spoke to me. I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. You know, physical things like food and water are important, but Jesus tells us that welcoming a stranger is just as important. Helping others to know God's love is important. And we don't do it by quoting scripture passages to them or shaming them for not knowing the correct lingo or where to sit or assuming that they know anything about the church at all. We share God's love by assuming nothing. I have another picture if Nick's ready for us. I shared this at our leadership training last weekend. This was written by a six-year-old in one of my previous congregations, and we were having a visioning session, and we were talking about what we loved about the church or what the church meant to us. And Hannah, in all her wisdom, wrote that. Most people in my school don't go to church. Hannah understood what a lot of adults don't. Being part of a church, even marginally, isn't part of everyone's life experience. And so I try to be intentional about things like including the words to the Lord's Prayer in the bulletin, because I know that there are people who don't know the words, who never learned it. I use the word entryway instead of narthex, because only church people know what a narthex is, and some of us don't even know what that is, right? I try to remember what it was like to walk into church for the very first time where I knew no one, and I wondered where it was okay to sit and how I should act. A few weeks ago, someone, a guest here, asked me, can I just sit anywhere I want to? I still remember the couple who invited Ted and I to stay for a cup of coffee after worship the very first time we worshiped in a church. We were in our late 20s, newly married, and they were in their 70s, but we became good friends. I also try and remember we have a whole lot of people watching on Zoom and YouTube, and so I try and engage them and make them feel welcomed and included in our worship experience. Sometimes I specifically choose things or leave things out of worship so that we all feel a part of worship together. And what happens in worship is really important to me. I care deeply about every person who made the effort to be here today, especially today, but every Sunday, because I know that sometimes just showing up is the hardest part. But I also care about those who aren't here for a variety of reasons. And to me, hospitality is more than just a warm welcome or remembering someone's name. I believe hospitality is seeing a need and doing our best to meet it. It's about generosity and love and sharing the gifts we've been given, like Hosea in the children's message. So not to toot our own horn, little pun there, but as an example of hospitality, I wanted to share a story from Mount Horeb, the previous congregation where I served. So Mount Horeb is, the church itself is on the path for Ironman, Wisconsin, the cyclist path. So if you don't know what that is, it's a grueling triathlon that people from all over the world participate in. I only marginally knew what it was until I moved to Mount Horeb. And for months before the race itself, cyclists are training. Every weekend, hundreds of cyclists ride past the church. On Ironman Sunday itself, there's lots of activity all over the community. It's just filled with people and cyclists and spectators. But I have to be honest and say that the church itself wasn't so excited about all those cyclists, because it was really difficult to get in and out of the church parking lot on Ironman Sunday. It was really difficult to get anywhere in the community that day. And you know, if you've driven around on a country road and come up behind a cyclist in your car, you know that sometimes it's hard to get around them. And to be honest, the people at the church were a bit grumpy about Ironman when I first arrived. But Ted and I had a vantage point from our parsonage where we could sit on our deck and we watched cyclist after cyclist go past on the weekend. Sometimes after church on Sunday morning, we would talk to them and hear their stories, learn about how they trained, and sometimes their friends were sitting in our church parking lot waiting for them to come by. This was long before race day. And so we asked, how could we help? And the answer was simple. Water. Not on race day, because we couldn't do anything to help the cyclists that day or they would be disqualified. But they said sometimes when they were out training, it was difficult to find a place to refill their water bottles. And wouldn't it be great if the church could just put some water out? Well, it wasn't quite that simple because we didn't have a hose that could reach that far. But we made it work. An idea was born, and every weekend we would put water out for the cyclists. Word spread, and people began to look forward to the water. Cyclists called and left messages on the church answering machine thanking us for the water. There was messages and pictures on our church Facebook page. People posted saying thanking us for the water. The next Ironman Day, we held a celebration. We called it Brats and Bikes, and we put bike brats in the parking lot, and we cheered, and we made a lot of noise, and it was super fun. And as far as I know, they're still doing that every year. We would give brats to the police officers who were directing traffic down the street, and one of them said to me the last year that we were there, he said, well, I just request this intersection every year because I know y'all are going to take real good care of me. And we became known as the Water Church. Everywhere I went, when I said where I served, people would say, oh, is that the church with the water? Even the pastor at Covenant Presbyterian, when I went to do the community Thanksgiving service, said, hey, I stopped for water at that church in Mount Horeb all the time when I rode my bike past there. But it wasn't about the water. It was about the welcome. It was about seeing a need and meeting it in a way that we showed that we loved and cared for our neighbors. Think about a gift that you've been given. My sister would call it something like a home run, you know, the perfect gift. Think about the person, you know, you picked out that gift, that someone, and you knew that they would appreciate it. Or maybe you didn't even know how much that gift was going to mean, but when the person got it, they were so surprised and appreciated that you were touched. How did that make you feel? That's hospitality, right? Caring about another person and not just about ourselves. That's what living a life of generosity and hospitality is all about. One of the things that I share is that, you know, when we're in a church, it's kind of like a family, right? And we can't always have everything that we like in our family. I don't know about you, but I don't get my favorite meal for dinner every single night. Sometimes I make someone else in the family's favorite meal. And when I prepare a special meal for someone in my family or for a guest, I'm really happy when they enjoy it. I'm pleased when they feel loved by my actions. And for me, that's what hospitality is about. When we feel and know God's love, we can't help but want to share it. Sharing God's love is about recognizing the abundance of love that God has for us and wanting to share it with everyone that we meet. It's a good thing about love, right? And especially God's love. There's no need to hoard it. There's enough for everyone. There's more than enough for everyone. So let us think of ways that we can be generous. Think of ways that we can be hospitable. Think of ways that we can share God's love. I know that we're already really good at that, and yet there's a lot of Hannah's friends out there who are waiting for us to think of new ways. Amen. I'll invite you to stand for our next hymn. It's 344 in the red hymnals, Lord, You Have Come to the Lakeshore. And again, I'll remind you, if you wanted to come and light a candle during one of the hymns, you're more than welcome to.
Thank you.
Please be seated. At this time, I'm going to give you a moment, if you haven't already, to prepare your offering. If you're in the sanctuary, there's offering plates in the back. As you leave today, you can put it in there. Also, there's a QR code or the website or a text number in your bulletin. And the same thing, if you're on the Zoom call, you can use any of those, or there's a mailing address as well. And just thank you again for continuing to support all of our ministries here. Let us pray. Oh God, as we offer some of what we have back to you, we thank you for your generosity, for your amazing abundance of love for us, for the welcome that we have received into your family. And we pray that these gifts might help others to know and feel that love as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In our time of prayer together, I think we want to just pray for safety for all those out on the roads today, and for all of you who are in the sanctuary, safe travels back home. I also want to lift up that yesterday was the funeral for Walt Thiessen, and give thanks for those who helped with that, and just continue to keep the family in our prayers. I also want to lift up Jessica Crombie. Her mom is in hospice and kind of in the last probably hours of her life. So Jessica asked for me to announce that, and also asked especially if you would keep Jack and Tom in your prayers, as it's a pretty tough time for all of them. Let us pray. Oh God, as we come this day, as we lift up our friends and family who are hurting, we trust you. We entrust them to your care. And sometimes when we don't know what else to do, we wonder if that's enough. And yet we know that your presence is enough, that your love is what we need on the best of days and on the worst of days. Oh God, fill those who are hurting this day with your love. Fill us with your love and your hope so that we might share it with those that we meet. Oh God, we give thanks for those who have helped us on our journey of faith, for those who have walked with us in the deepest, darkest of our sorrows, and those who celebrate with us on joyous days. Oh God, may we be that loving presence to all those we meet. May we share your love and your hope with this world. In Jesus' name we pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And I invite you now to join in singing our closing song, which is number 432, Yesu, Yesu.
Sorry.
I just want to point out lots of things happening in the next few weeks, so make sure you grab a bulletin on your way out if you don't already have one with all the events there. And if you're on the Zoom call, you should be able to click on and get that from the website as well. I want to point out that next Saturday, we're having game night, and our king of hospitality, Steve, is going to make a taco bar for us. So instead of a potluck, we're going to have a nacho taco bar. So that's going to be really fun. So I hope that all of you can join for that as we share some fellowship and some time together as a church family. And as we go, I just want to thank you again for your generosity and your hospitality. May you know the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit this day and every day. Go in peace. Go in love. Amen.